hide the Christmas tree carefully, Helen. Be sure the children do not see it until this evening when it is dressed. How much?
Sixpence.
There's a shilling. No, keep the change.
Thank you, ma'am.
Yes, he is in.
Is that my little lark twittering out there?
Yes, it is.
Is it my little squirrel bustling about?
Yes.
Oh, when did my squirrel come home?
Just now. Come in here, Torvald, and see what I've bought.
Don't disturb me. Bought, did you say? All these things. Has my little spendthrift been wasting money again?
Yes, but this year we really can let ourselves go a little, Torvald. This is the first Christmas that we've not needed to economize.
Still, you know, we can't spend money recklessly.
Yes, but we may be a wee bit more reckless now, mayn't we? Just a teeny wee bit? You're going to have a big salary and earn lots and lots of money.
Yes, after the new year. But then it will be a whole quarter before the salary is due.
Oh, poo, we can borrow until then.
Nora. The same little featherhead. Suppose, now, that I borrowed £50 today and you spent it all in the Christmas week. And then on New Year's Eve, a slate fell on my head and killed me. And
oh, this is the four things!
Still, suppose that happened. What then?
Well, if that were to happen, I don't suppose I should care whether I owed money or not.
Yes, but what about the people who had lent it?
They? Who would bother about them? I should not know who they were.
That is like a woman. But seriously, Nora, you know what I think about that. No debt, no borrowing. There can be no freedom of beauty about a home life that depends on borrowing and debt. We two have kept bravely on the straight road so far, and we will go on the same way for the short time longer that there need be any struggle.
As you please, Torvald.
Come, come, my little skylark must not droop her wings. Oh, what is this? Is my little squirrel out of temper? Nora, what do you think I've got here?
Money?
There you are. Don't you think I don't know what a lot is wanted for housekeeping at Christmas time? Hmm?
10 shillings? A pound? Mm-hmm. 2 pounds? Thank you, thank you, thank you, Torvald. This will keep me going for a long time.
Indeed, it must.
Yes, it will. But come here and let me show you what I have bought, and also cheap. Look, here is a new suit for Ivor, and a sword, and a horse and trumpet for Bob, and a doll and Dolly's bedstead for Emmy. They are very plain, but she will soon break them in pieces. And here are dress links and handkerchiefs for the maids. Old Annette have really ought to have something better.
And what is in this parcel?
No, you mustn't see that until this evening.
Oh, very well, very well. But now, tell me, you extravagant little person, what would you like for yourself?
For myself? Oh, I'm sure I don't want anything.
Oh, yes, but you must. Tell me something reasonable that you would particularly like to have.
No, I really can't think of anything. Unless, Torvald.
Well?
If you really want to give me something, you might...
Well, out with it.
You might give me money, Torvald. Only just as much as you can afford. And then one of these days, I will buy something with it.
But Nora, I...
Oh, no, please, dear Torvald, please do. Then I will wrap it up in beautiful gilt paper and hang it on the Christmas tree. Wouldn't that be fun?
What are little people called that are always wasting money?
Spendthrifts, I know. Mm-hmm. Let us do as you suggest, Torvald, and then I shall have time to think what I'm most in want of. That is a very sensible plan, isn't it?
Indeed it is. That is to say, if you were really to save some of the money I give you and then really buy something for yourself. But if you spend it all on the housekeeping and any number of unnecessary things, then I merely have to pay up again.
No, but Torvald!
You can't deny it, my dear little Nora. It's a sweet little spendthrift, but she uses up a deal of money. One would hardly believe how expensive such little persons are.
Ashamed to say that. I really do save all I can.
That's very true. All you can. But you can't save anything.
You haven't any idea how many expenses we Skylarks and Squirrels have, Torvald.
You are an odd little soul. Very like your father. You always find some new way of wheedling money out of me, and as soon as you've got it, seems to melt in your hands. You never know where it has gone. Still, one must take you as you are. It is in blood. For indeed, it is true that you can inherit these things, Nora.
I wish I had inherited many of Papa's qualities.
And I would not wish you to be anything but just what you are, my sweet little Skylark. But do you know, it strikes me that you are looking rather, what shall I say, rather uneasy today.
Do I?
Oh, you do. Really. Look straight at me.
Well?
Hasn't Miss Sweet Tooth been breaking rules in town today?
No! What makes you say that?
Hasn't she paid a visit to the confectioners?
No, I assure you, Torvald.
Oh, not nibbling sweets?
No, certainly not.
Not even taken a bite of a macaroon or two?
No, Torvald, I assure you.
There. Of course, I was only joking.
I should not think to go against your wishes.
Oh, I am sure of that. Besides, you gave me your word. Keep your little Christmas secrets to yourself, my darling. They will all be revealed tonight when the Christmas tree is lit, no doubt.
Did you remember to invite Dr. Rank?
No, but there is no need. As a matter of course, he will come to dinner with us. However, I will ask him when he comes in this morning. I have ordered some good wine. Nora, you can't think how I am looking forward to this evening.
So am I. And how the children will enjoy themselves, Torvald.
It is splendid to feel that one has a perfectly safe appointment and a big enough income. It's delightful to think of, isn't it?
It's wonderful.
Do you remember last Christmas? For a full 3 weeks beforehand, you shut yourself up every evening until long after midnight, making ornaments for the Christmas tree and all the other fine things that were to be a surprise to us. It was the dullest 3 weeks I ever spent.
I didn't find it dull.
Yeah, but there was precious little result, Nora.
Oh, you shouldn't tease me about that again. How could I help the cats going in and tearing everything to pieces?
Of course you couldn't, poor little girl. You had the best of intentions to please us all, and that's the main thing. But it is a good thing that our hard times are over.
Yes, it is really wonderful.
This time I needn't sit here and be dull all alone, and you needn't ruin your dear eyes and your pretty little hands.
No, Torvald, I needn't any longer, need I? It's wonderful to hear you say so. Now, I will tell you how I've been thinking we ought to arrange things, Torvald. As soon as Christmas is over, I'm going to... There's the door! There's someone at the door! What a nuisance!
If it is a caller, remember I am not at home.
A lady to see you, ma'am. A stranger.
Ask her to come in.
The doctor came at the same time, sir.
Did he go straight into my room?
Yes, sir.
How do you do, Nora?
How do you do?
You don't recognize me, I suppose.
No, I don't know. Yes, to be sure, I seem to... Yes! Christine, is it really you?
Yes, it is I.
Christine, to think of my not recognizing you. And yet, how could I? How you have altered, Christine.
Yes, I have, indeed. In 9, 10 long years.
Is it so long since we met? I suppose it is. The last 8 years have been a happy time, I can tell you. And so now you have come into town and have taken this long journey in winter. That was plucky of you.
I arrived by steamer this morning.
To have some fun at Christmas time, of course. How delightful. We will have such fun together. But take off your things. You're not cold, I hope. Now, we will sit down by the stove and be cozy. No, 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 take this armchair. I will sit here in the rocking chair. Now you look like your old self again. It was only in that first moment. You're a little paler, Christine, and perhaps a little thinner.
And much, much older.
Perhaps a little older. Very, very little. Certainly not much. What a thoughtless creature. I am chattering away like this. My poor dear Christine. Do forgive me.
What do you mean, Nora?
Poor Christine, you were a widow.
Yes. It is 3 years ago now.
Yes. I knew. I saw it in the papers. I assure you, Christine, I meant ever so often to write to you at the time, but I always was put off by something. Oh, something always prevented me. And
I quite understand, dear.
It was very bad of me, Christine. Poor thing, how you must have suffered. And he left you nothing?
No.
And no children?
No.
Nothing at all, then?
Not even any sorrow or grief to live upon.
But, Christine, is that possible?
It sometimes happens, Nora.
So you were quite alone. How dreadfully sad that must be. Well, I have 3 lovely children. You can't see them just now, for they're out with the nurse. But now you must tell me all about it.
No. No, I want to hear about you.
No, no, no. You must begin. I mustn't be selfish today. Today I must only think of your affairs. Oh, but there is one thing I must tell you. Do you know we have just had a great piece of good luck?
No. What is it?
Just fancy. My husband has been made manager of the bank.
Your husband? What good luck?
Yes, tremendous. A barrister's profession is such an uncertain thing, especially if you won't take unsavory cases. And naturally, Torvald has never been willing to do that, and I quite agree with him. You may imagine how pleased we are. He is to take up his work at the bank in the new year, and then he will have a big salary and lots of commissions. For the future, we can live quite differently. We can do just as we like. Oh, I feel so relieved and so happy, Christine. It will be splendid to have heaps of money and not need to have any anxiety, won't it?
Yes. Anyhow, I think it would be delightful to have what one needs.
Not only what one needs, but what one wants, but heaps and heaps of money.
Nora, haven't you learned sense yet? In our school days, you were a great spendthrift.
Yes, that is what Torvald says now. But Nora is not so silly as you think. We have not been in a position for me to waste money. We've both had to work.
You too?
Yes, odds and ends, needlework, crochet work, embroidery, that kind of thing. And other things as well. Well, you know Torvald left his office when we were married. There was no prospect of promotion there, and he had to try and earn more than before, but during the first year, he overworked himself dreadfully. You see, he had to make money every way he could, and he worked early and late, but he couldn't stand it and felt dreadfully ill, and the doctor said it was necessary for him to go south.
You spent a whole year in Italy, didn't you?
Yes. It was no easy matter to get away, I can tell you. It was just after Ivor was born, but naturally we had to go. It was a wonderfully beautiful journey, and it saved Torvald's life, but it cost a tremendous lot of money, Christine.
So I should think.
It cost about £250. That's a lot, isn't it?
Yes, and in emergencies like that, it is lucky to have the money.
Well, I ought to tell you, we had it from Papa.
Oh, I see. It was just about that time he died, wasn't it?
Yes. And just think of it, I couldn't go and nurse him. I was expecting Ivor's birth every day, and I had my poor sick Torvald to look after. My dear, kind father, I never saw him again, Christine. That was the saddest time I've known since our marriage.
I know how fond you were of him. And then you went off to Italy.
Yes. You see, we had the money then, and the doctors insisted on our going, so we started a month later.
And your husband came back quite well?
As sound as a bell.
But the doctor?
What doctor?
I thought your maid said the gentleman who arrived here just as I did was the doctor?
Yes, that was Dr. Rank, but he doesn't come here professionally. He's our greatest friend and comes in, well, at least once a day. No, Torvald has not had an hour's illness since then, and our children are strong and healthy, and so am I. Christine, it's good to be alive and happy, but oh, how horrid of me. I am talking of nothing but my own affairs. You mustn't be angry with me. Tell me, is it really true that you did not love your husband? Why did you marry him?
My mother was alive then, and was bedridden and helpless. And I had to provide for my two younger brothers, so I did not think I was justified in refusing his offer.
No, perhaps you are quite right. He was rich at that time, then?
I believe he was quite well off. But his business was a precarious one, and when he died, it all went to pieces and there was nothing left.
And then?
Well, I had to turn my hand to anything I could find. First a small shop, then a small school, and so on. The last 3 years have seemed like one long working day with no rest. Now it is at an end, Nora. My poor mother needs me no more, for she is gone. And the boys do not need me either. They have got situations and can shift for themselves.
Oh, what a relief you must feel if that's...
No. Oh, indeed. I only feel my life unspeakably empty. No one to live for anymore. That was why I could not stand the life in my little backwater any longer. I hope it may be easier here to find something which will busy me and occupy my thoughts. If only I could have the good luck to get some regular work, office work or of some kind.
But Christine, that is so frightfully tiring. And you look tired now. You'd far better go away to some watering place.
I have no father to give me money for a journey, Nora.
Oh, don't be angry with me.
It is you that must not be angry with me, dear. The worst of a position like mine is that it makes one so bitter. No one to work for, and yet obliged to always be on the lookout for chances. One must live, and so one becomes selfish. When you told me of the happy turn your fortunes have taken, you will hardly believe it. I was delighted not so much on your account as on my own.
How do you mean? Oh, I understand. You mean that perhaps Torvald could get you something to do?
Yes, that is what I was thinking of.
Oh, he must, Christine. Just leave it to me. I will broach the subject very cleverly. I will think of something that will please him very much. It will make me so happy to be of some use to you.
How kind you are, Nora, to be so anxious to help me. It is doubly kind in you, for you know so little of the burdens and troubles of life.
I know so little of them.
My dear, small household cares and that sort of thing. You are a child, Nora.
You ought not to be so superior.
No?
You are just like the others. They all think that I am incapable of anything really serious.
Come, come.
That I've gone through nothing in this world of cares.
But, my dear Nora, you have just told me all your troubles.
Pooh, those were trifles. I have not told you the important thing.
The important thing? What do you mean?
You look down upon me altogether, Christine, but you ought not to. You are proud, aren't you, of having worked so hard and so long for your mother?
Indeed, I don't look down on anyone. But it is true that I am both proud and glad to think that I was privileged to make the end of my mother's life almost free from care.
And you are proud to think of what you have done for your brothers?
I think I have the right to be.
I think so, too. But now listen to this. I, too, have something to be proud and glad of.
I have no doubt you have. But what do you refer to?
Speak low. Suppose Torvald were to hear. He mustn't on any account. No one in the world must know, Christine, except you.
But what is it?
Come here. Now, I will show you that I, too, have something to be proud and glad of. It was I who saved Torvald's life.
Saved? How?
I told you about our trip to Italy. Torvald would never have recovered if he had not gone there.
Yes, but your father gave you the necessary funds.
Yes, that is what Torvald and all the others think,
But?
Papa didn't give us a shilling. It was I who procured the money.
You? All that large sum?
250 pounds. What do you think of that?
But, Nora, how could you possibly do it? Did you win a prize in the lottery?
In the lottery? There would have been no credit in that.
But where did you get it from? Because you couldn't have borrowed it.
Couldn't I? Why not?
No, a wife cannot borrow without her husband's consent.
Oh, if it is a wife who has any head for business. A wife who has the wit to be a little bit clever.
I don't understand it at all, Nora.
There's no need you should. I never said I'd borrowed the money. I may have got it some other way. Perhaps I got it from some admirer, when anyone is as attractive as I am.
You are a mad creature.
Now you know you're full of curiosity, Christine.
Listen to me, Nora, dear. Haven't you been a little bit imprudent?
Is it imprudent to save your husband's life?
It seems to me imprudent without his knowledge to.
But it was absolutely necessary that he should not know. My goodness, can't you understand that? It was necessary. He should have no idea what a dangerous condition he was in. It was to me that the doctors came and said that his life was in danger and that the only thing to save him was to live in the South. Do you suppose I didn't try at first to get what I wanted as if it were for myself? I told him how much I should love to travel abroad like other young wives. I tried tears and entreaties with him. I told him that he ought to remember the condition I was in and that he ought to be kind and indulgent to me. I even hinted that he might raise a loan. That nearly made him angry, Christine. He said I was thoughtless and that it was his duty as my husband not to indulge my whims and caprices, as I believe he called them. Very well, I thought, you must be saved. And that was how I came to devise a way out of the difficulty.
And did your husband never get to know from your father that the money had not come from him?
No, never. Papa died just at that time. I had meant to let him into the secret and beg him never to reveal it, but he was so ill then. Alas, there was never any need to tell him.
And since then, you've never told your secret to your husband?
Good heavens, no! How could you think so? A man who has such strong opinions about these things. And besides, how painful and humiliating it would be for Torvald with his manly independence to know that he owed me anything. It would upset our mutual relations altogether. Our beautiful, happy home would no longer be what it is now.
Do you mean never to tell him about it?
Yes. Someday, perhaps. After many years, when I'm no longer as nice-looking as I am now. Oh, don't laugh at me. I mean, of course, when Torvald is no longer as devoted to me as he is now. When my dancing and dressing up and reciting have palled on him. Then it may be good to have something in reserve. What nonsense. That time will never come. Now, what do you think of my great secret, Christine? Do you still think I am of no use? I can tell you, too, that this affair has caused me a lot of worry. It has by no means been easy for me to meet my engagements punctually. I may tell you that there is something that is called, in business, quarterly interest, and another thing called payment in installments. And it is always so dreadfully difficult to manage them. I've had to save a little here and there where I could, you understand. I've not been able to put aside much from my housekeeping money, for Torvald must have a good table. I couldn't let my children be shabbily dressed. I felt obliged to use up all he gave me for them, the sweet little darlings.
So it all had to come out of your own necessities of life, poor Nora?
Of course. Besides, I was responsible for it. Whenever Torvald has given me money for new dresses and such things, I've never spent more than half of it. I've always bought the simplest and cheapest things. Oh, thank heaven any clothes look well on me, and so Torvald has never noticed. But it was so often very hard on me, Christine, because it is so delightful to be really well-dressed, isn't it?
Quite so.
Well, then I have found other ways of earning money. Last winter, I was lucky enough to get a little copying to do, so I locked myself up and sat writing every evening until quite late at night. Many a time I was desperately tired, but all the same, it was tremendous pleasure to sit there working and earning money. It was quite like being a man.
How much have you been able to pay off in that way?
I can't tell you exactly. See, it is very difficult to keep an account of a business matter of that kind. I only know that I have paid every penny that I could scrape together. Many a time I was at my wit's end. Then I used to sit here and imagine that a rich old gentleman had fallen in love with me.
What? Who was it?
Be quiet. That he had died, and that when his will was opened up, it contained written in big letters the instruction, "The lovely Mrs. Nora Helmer is to have all I possess paid over to her at once in cash."
But, my dear Nora, who could that man be?
Good gracious! Can't you understand there's no gentleman at all? It was only something I used to sit here and imagine when I couldn't think of any way of procuring money. But it's all the same now. The tiresome old person can stay where he is, as far as I'm concerned. I don't care about him or his will either, for I am free from care now. Oh my goodness! It's delightful to think of Christine free from care, to be able to be free from care. Quite free from care, to be able to play and romp with the children, to be able to keep the house beautifully and have everything just as Torvald likes it. And to think, soon the spring will come and the big blue sky, and perhaps we shall be able to take another trip. Perhaps I can see the sea again. Oh, it's a wonderful thing to be alive and happy.
There is the bell. Perhaps I'd better go.
No, don't go. No one will come in here. It's sure to be for Torvald.
Excuse me, ma'am. There is a gentleman to see the master, and as the doctor is with him.
Who is it?
It is I, Mrs. Helmer.
You? Oh, what is it? What do you want to see my husband about?
Oh, banking business. I have a small post in the bank, and I hear your husband is to be a chief now.
Then it is just
dry business matters. Nothing more. Absolutely nothing else.
Be so good as to go into the study then.
Nora, who was that man?
A lawyer of the name of Krogstad.
Then it really was he.
Do you know the man?
I used to, many years ago. At one time, he was a solicitor's clerk in our town.
Yes, he was.
He is greatly altered.
He made a very unhappy marriage.
He is a widower now, isn't he?
With several children. Oh, there now, it is burning up.
They say he carries on various kinds of business.
Really? Oh, perhaps he does. I don't know anything about it. Oh, but don't let us think of business. It is so tiresome.
No, my dear fellow, I won't disturb you. I would rather go into your wife for a little while. Oh, I beg your pardon. I am afraid I am disturbing you too.
No, not at all. Dr. Rick, Mrs. Lind.
Oh, I have often heard Mrs. Lind's name mentioned here. I think I passed you on the stairs when I arrived, Mrs. Lind.
Yes, I go up very slowly. I can't manage stairs well.
Ah. Some slight internal weakness?
No, the fact is I have been overworking myself.
Nothing more than that. Then I suppose you have come to town to amuse yourself with our entertainments.
I have come to look for work.
Is that a good cure for overwork?
One must live, Dr. Rank.
Yes, the general opinion seems to be that is necessary.
Look here, Dr. Rank, you know you want to live.
Oh, certainly. However, wretched, I feel. I want to prolong the agony as long as possible. All my patients are like that. And so are those who are morally diseased. One of them, and a bad case too, is at this very moment with Helmer.
Oh, who do you mean?
A lawyer. Of the name of Krogstad, a fellow you don't know at all. He, suffers from a diseased moral character, Mrs. Helmer. But even he began talking of its being highly important that he should live.
Did he? What did he want to speak to Torvald about?
I have no idea. I only heard that it was something about the bank.
I didn't know this. What's his name? Krogstad had anything to do with the bank?
Yes, he has some sort of appointment there. Oh, I don't know whether you find also in your part of the world that there are certain people who go zealously snuffing about to smell out moral corruption, and as soon as they have found some, put the person concerned into some lucrative position where they can keep their eye on him. Healthy natures are left out in the cold.
Still, I think the sick are those who most need taking care of.
Yes, there you are. That is the sentiment that is turning society into a sick house. And why do you laugh at that? Have you any notion what society really is?
What do I care about? Tiresome society. I'm laughing at something quite different. Something extremely amusing. Tell me, Dr. Rank, are all the people who are employed in the bank dependent on Torvald now?
Is that what you find so extremely amusing?
That's my affair. It's perfectly glorious to think that we have, that Torvald has so much power over so many people. Yes. Dr. Rank, what do you say to a macaroon?
What? Macaroons? I thought they were forbidden here.
Yes, but these are some Christine gave me.
What?
Don't be alarmed. You couldn't know that Torvald had forbidden them. I must tell that he's very afraid that he will spoil my teeth. Yeah, once in a way. That's so, isn't it, Dr. Rank? By your leave. You must have one too, Christine. And I shall have one. Just a little one. Or at most, two. I am tremendously happy. There's just one thing in the world that I should dearly love to do.
Well, what is that?
It's something I should dearly love to say, if Torvald could hear me.
Well, why can't you say it?
No, I daren't. It's so shocking.
Shocking?
Well, I should not advise you to say it. Still, with us, you might. What is it you would so much like to say if Torvald could hear you?
I should just love to say, well, I'll be damned.
Oh, are you mad?
Nora, dear.
Say it. Here he is.
Hush, hush, hush. Oh. Well, Torvald, dear, have you got rid of him?
Yes. He has just gone.
Let me introduce you. This is Christine, who has come to town.
Christine, excuse me, but I don't know.
Mrs. Lind, dear. Christine Lind.
Ah, of course. School friend of my wife's, I presume?
Yes, we have known each other since then.
And just think, she has taken a long journey in order to see you.
What do you mean?
No, really, I...
Christine is tremendously clever at bookkeeping, and she is frightfully anxious to work under some clever man so as to perfect herself.
Very sensible, Mrs. Lind.
And when she heard you had been appointed manager of the bank, the news was telegraphed, you know, she traveled here as quick as she could. Torvald, I am sure you will be able to do something for Christine, for my sake, won't you?
Well, it is not altogether impossible. I presume you are a widow, Mrs. Lind.
Yes.
And have had some experience of bookkeeping?
Yes, a fair amount.
Ah, well, it's very likely I may be able to find something for you.
What did I tell you? What did I tell you?
You have just come at a fortunate moment, Mrs. Lind.
How am I to thank you?
There's no need, but today you must excuse me.
Wait a minute. I will come with you.
Don't be away long, Torvald, dear.
About an hour, not more.
Are you going too, Christine?
Yes, I must go and look for a room.
Oh, well then, we can walk down the street together.
What a pity it is we are so short of space here. I'm afraid it is impossible.
Oh, please don't think of it. Goodbye, Nora, dear, and many thanks.
Goodbye for the present. Of course you will come back this evening. You too, Dr. Rink. What do you say? If you are well enough? Oh, you must be. Wrap yourself up well. Oh, there are the children. There they are. Come in, come in. Oh, sweet blessings. Look at them, Christine. Aren't they darlings?
Then let us stand here in the draft.
Come along, Mrs. Lynde. The place will only be bearable for a mother now.
Oh, how fresh and well you look. Such red cheeks like apples and roses. Have you had great fun? Splendid. What? You pulled both Emmy and Bob on the sledge? Both at once? That was good. That was clever of you, Ivor. Oh, Anne, let me take her for a little. My sweet little baby doll. Yes, Mother will dance with Bob too. What? You went snowballing? Oh, I wish I could have been there. No. Let me take their things off, Anne. It's such great fun. Go in. You look half frozen. There's some hot coffee for you on the stove. What? Did a dog chase you? It didn't bite you, did it? No, dogs don't bite nice little doll children. No, Ivor, don't look at the parcels. What are they? I dare say you would like to know what they are. No. Come. Let's have a game. What shall we play at? Hide and seek? Bob, would you? Shall I hide first? Very well, I will hide first. Are you ready? Oh, wonderful. Who's going to get? Shall I go? Okay.
Oh, such lovely children. Oh, excuse me, Mrs. Elm.
What do you want?
Oh, excuse me. The outer door was ajar. I suppose someone forgot to shut it.
My husband is out, Mr. Krogstad.
Oh, I know.
What do you want here, then?
Oh, a word with you.
With me? Go into the nurse. What? No. The strange man won't do Mother any harm. When he is gone, we will have another game. You want to speak to me?
Yes, I do.
Today? It's not the first of the month yet.
No. It is Christmas Eve. And it will depend on yourself what sort of Christmas you will spend.
What do you mean? Today it is absolutely impossible for me to get you...
We won't talk about that until later on. This is something different. I presume that you can give me a moment.
Yes, I can, although Torvald could be...
I was in Olson's restaurant, and I saw your husband going down the street.
Yes?
With a lady.
What then?
May I be so bold as to ask, was it a Mrs. Lynde?
It was.
Just arrived in town?
Yes, today.
She's a great friend of yours, isn't she?
She is, but I don't see
her. I know her too, once upon a time.
I am aware of that.
Are you? So you know all about it. I thought as much. Well, then I can ask you without beating about the bush. Is Mrs. Lynde to have an appointment in the bank?
What right have you to question me, Mr. Krogstad? You, one of my husband's subordinates. But since you ask, you shall know. Yes, Mrs. Lynde is to have an appointment, and it was I who pleaded her case, Mr. Krogstad, let me tell you that.
I was right in what I thought then.
Sometimes one has a tiny little bit of influence, I should hope. Because one is a woman, it does not necessarily follow that when anyone is in a subordinate position, Mr. Krogstad, they should really be careful to avoid offending anyone who has influence? Exactly.
Mrs. Helmer, would you be so kind as to use your influence on my behalf?
What? What do you mean?
You will be so kind as to see that I am allowed to keep my small post in the bank.
What do you mean by that? Who proposes to take your post away from you?
There's no necessity to keep up the pretense of ignorance. I'm quite aware that your friend does not want to risk the chance of rubbing shoulders with me. I'm also quite aware that I know who is responsible for me being turned out.
But I assure you, I had nothing to do with...
Oh, very likely, very likely. To come to the point, the time has come for me to advise you to use your influence to prevent that.
But Mr. Krogstad, I have no influence.
Haven't you? But you just said just now.
Naturally, I did not mean you to put that construction on it. I? What should make you think I have any influence of that kind with my husband?
I've known your husband since our school days. I don't suppose he's any more unassailable than other husbands.
If you speak slightingly of my husband, I shall turn you out of the house.
Oh, you are bold, Mrs. Helmer.
I'm not afraid of you any longer. As soon as the new year comes, I shall in a very short time be free of the whole thing.
Listen to me, Mrs. Helmer. I am prepared to fight for my small, subordinate position. As if I were fighting for my life.
So it seems.
No, it's not for the money. No, indeed, that has the least to do with it in this matter. I may as well tell you, my position is this. I dare say you know, like everyone else, that once a long time ago, I was guilty of an indiscretion.
I think I've heard something of the kind.
You know, that matter never came into court, but every way seemed to be closed to me after that. So I took to the business that you know of. I mean, I had to do something. And frankly, I don't think I'm one of the worst. But now I must cut myself free of all of that. My sons are growing up, and for their sake, I must try to get back as much respect as I can in this town. That small post was my first step up. And now your husband is going to kick me downstairs again into the mud?
But you must believe me, Mr. Krogstad. It is not in my power to help you at all.
Well, that's because you don't have the will. But I have the means to compel you.
You don't mean that you will tell my husband that I owe you money?
Suppose I were to tell him.
It would be perfectly infamous of you. To think of his learning my secret, which has been my joy and pride, in such an ugly, clumsy way, that he should learn it from you? It would put me in a horribly disagreeable position.
Only disagreeable.
Well, do it then, and it will be the worse for you. My husband will see for himself what a blackguard you are, and you certainly won't keep your post then.
I asked you if it was only a disagreeable scene that you were afraid of.
If my husband does get to know of it, of course he will pay at once what is still owing, and we shall have nothing more to do with you.
Listen to me, Mrs. Helmer. Either you have a very bad memory, or you know very little of business, and I shall be obliged to remind you of a few details.
What do you mean?
When your husband was ill, you came to me to borrow £250.
I didn't know anyone else to go to.
I promised to get you that amount.
Yes, and you did so.
I promised to get you that amount on certain conditions. Now, your mind must have been taken up with your husband's illness, and you were so anxious to get that money for your trip abroad. But you seem to have paid very little attention to the conditions of our bargain. Therefore, it would not be amiss of me to remind you of them. Now, I promised to get you the money on the security of a bond, which I drew up.
Yes, and which I signed.
Good. But below your signature were a few lines constituting your father, a surety for the money. Now, those lines your father should have signed.
Should? Well, he did sign them.
Now, I had left the date blank. That is to say, your father should have himself inserted the date on which he signed the papers. Do you remember that?
Yes, I think I remember.
Then I gave you the bond to send to by post to your father. Is that not so?
Yes.
And naturally, you did so at once because 5 or 6 days afterwards, you brought me the bond with your father's signature. Then I gave you money.
Well, haven't I been paying it off regularly?
Fairly well so, yes, yes. But to come back to the matter at hand, oh, that must have been a very trying time for you.
It was, indeed.
Your father was very ill, wasn't he?
He was very near his end.
And he died soon after.
Yes.
Tell me, Mrs. Helmer, can you remember the day your father died? Of the month, I mean.
Papa died on the 29th of September.
That is correct. I ascertained that for myself. And as that is so, there's a discrepancy, which I cannot account for.
What discrepancy? I don't know what you mean.
The discrepancy is this, Mrs. Helmer. The fact that your father signed this bond 3 days after his death.
What do you mean? I don't understand what you're...
The father died on the 29th of September. But look here. Your father has dated his signature the 2nd of October. It's a discrepancy, isn't it? Can you explain to me what that is? I mean, and it's a remarkable thing also that the words 2nd of October as well as the year are not written in your father's handwriting, but in a handwriting I think I know. Well, of course, you know, it can be explained that your father may have forgotten to date the signature and someone else may have dated it haphazardly before they knew of his death. And, you know, there's no harm in that. No. It all depends on the signature of the name. And that is genuine, is it not? It was your father who signed his name here.
No, it was not. It was I that wrote Papa's name.
Are you aware that is a dangerous confession?
In what way? You shall have your money soon.
Let me ask you a question. Why did you not send the paper to your father?
It was impossible. Papa was so ill. If I had asked him for his signature, I should have had to tell him what the money was to be used for. And when he was so ill himself, I couldn't tell him that my husband's life was in danger. It was impossible.
It would have been better for you if you'd given up on your trip abroad.
No, that was impossible. The trip was to save my husband's life. I couldn't give that up.
Did it never occur to you that you were committing a fraud on me?
I couldn't take that into account. I didn't trouble myself about you at all. I couldn't bear you because you put so many heartless difficulties in my way, although you knew what a dangerous condition my husband was in.
Mrs. Helmer, you evidently do not realize clearly what it is that you are guilty of. But I can assure you, my one false step that lost me my reputation is nothing more and nothing worse than what you've done.
You, do you ask me to believe that you were brave enough to run a risk to save your wife's life?
The law cares nothing of motives.
Then it must be a very foolish law.
Foolish or not, it is the law by which you will be judged if I produce this paper in court.
I don't believe that. Is a daughter not to be allowed to spare her dying father anxiety and care? Is a wife not to be allowed to save her husband's life? I don't know much about the law, but I am certain that there must be laws permitting such things as that. Have you no knowledge of such laws? You, who are a lawyer, you must be a very poor lawyer, Mr. Krogstad.
That may be. But matters of business, such as the business that you and I have had, do you think I don't understand that? Very well. Do as you please. But let me tell you this. If I lose my position again, well, you should lose yours with me.
Nonsense. Trying to frighten me like that. I'm not so silly as he thinks. And yet... No, it's impossible. I did it for love's sake.
Ma'am, the strange man has gone out through the gate.
Yes, I know. But don't tell anyone about the strange man, do you hear? Not even Torvald.
No, ma'am. Will you be playing with the children?
No, not now.
But ma'am, you did promise.
Yes, but I can't now. Oh, bring the tree in.
Yes, ma'am. Where shall I put it?
Here in the middle of the floor.
Shall I get you anything else?
No, thank you. I have all I want. A candle here, flowers here. Horrible man, it's all nonsense. There's nothing wrong. The tree shall be splendid. I will do everything I can think of to please you, Torvald. I will sing for you. I will dance for you. Oh! You're back already.
Yes. Has anyone been here?
Here. No.
That is strange. I saw Krogstad going out of the gate.
Did you? Yes. I forgot. Krogstad was here for a moment.
Nora, I can see from your manner that he has been here begging you to say a good word for him.
Yes.
And you were to appear to do it of your own accord. You were to conceal from me the fact of his having been here. Didn't he beg that of you too?
Yes, Torvald, but
Nora, Nora. And you would be a party to that sort of thing? To have any talk with a man like that and give him any sort of promise? And to tell me a lie into the bargain?
A lie?
Didn't you tell me no one had been here? Hmm? My little songbird must never do that again. A songbird must have a clean beak to chirp with. No false notes. That is so, isn't it? Yes. Yes. I am sure it is. We will say no more about it. How warm and snug it is here.
Torvald!
Yes.
I am looking forward tremendously to the fancy dress ball at the Stenborgs the day after tomorrow.
Oh, and I am tremendously curious to see what you are going to surprise me with.
It was very silly of me to want to do that.
What do you mean?
Well, I can't hit upon anything that will do. Everything I think of seems so silly and insignificant.
Ah, does my little Nora acknowledge that at last?
Are you very busy, Torvald?
Well...
Oh, what are all those papers?
Bank business.
Already?
I've got authority from the retiring manager to undertake the necessary changes in the staff and in the rearrangement of the work. And I must make use of the Christmas week for that, so as to have everything in order for the new year.
Then that was why this poor Krogstad...
Hmm.
If you hadn't been so busy, I should have asked you a tremendously big favor, Torvald.
What is that? Tell me.
There's no one has such good taste as you, and I do so want to look nice at the fancy dress ball. Torvald, couldn't you take me in hand and decide what I shall go as, and what sort of dress I shall wear?
So my obstinate little woman is obliged to get someone to come to her rescue.
Yes, Torvald, I can't get along a bit without your help.
Very well. I will think it over. We shall manage to hit upon something.
That is nice of you. How pretty the red flowers look. But tell me, was it really something very bad this Krogstad was guilty of?
He forged someone's name. Have you any idea what that means?
Isn't it possible that he was driven to do so by necessity?
Yes. Or, as in so many cases, by imprudence. I'm not so heartless so as to condemn a man altogether because of a single false step of that kind.
No, you wouldn't, would you, Torvald?
Many a man has been able to retrieve his character if he has openly confessed his fault and taken his punishment.
Punishment?
But Krogstad did nothing of that sort. He got himself out of it by a cunning trick, and that is why he has gone under altogether.
But do you think that it would...
Think how a guilty man like that has to lie and play the hypocrite with everyone. Now he has to wear a mask in the presence of those near and dear to him, even before his own wife and children. And about the children, that is the most terrible part of it all, Nora.
How?
Because such an atmosphere of lies infects and poisons the whole life of a home. Each breath the children take in such a house is full of the germs of evil.
Are you sure of that?
My dear, I have often seen it in the course of my life as a lawyer. Almost everyone who has gone to the bad early in life has had a deceitful mother.
Why do you only say mother?
It seems most commonly to be the mother's influence. Though naturally a bad father's would have the same result. Every lawyer is familiar with the fact. This Krogstad now has been persistently poisoning his own children with lies and dissimulation. That is why I say he has lost all moral character. That is why my sweet little Nora must promise me not to plead his cause. Give me your hand on it. Come, what is this? Give me your hand. There now. That's settled. I assure you, it would be quite impossible for me to work with him. I literally feel physically ill when I am in the company of such people.
It is so hot in here. I have such a lot to do.
Yes, well, and I must try and read through some of these before dinner. And I must think about your costume, too. And it is just possible I may have something ready in gold paper to hang up on the tree. My precious little singing bird.
It isn't true. It's impossible. It must be impossible.
The little ones are begging so hard to be allowed to come into Mama.
No, don't let them come into me. You stay with them, Anne.
Very well, ma'am.
Deprave my little children? Poison my home? It's not true. It can't possibly be true!